America. This is Mabel.
I'm Nicole.
I'm Noe.
I'm Shefali.
And now our talk present. We'll be covering these five topics, and I'll be talking about the problem with existing information. Before that, let's talk about what does a research and consultant do. For a research and consultant, they have to compile all the reports and summaries of the data gathered, ensuring that the data are absolutely accurate. And their job is to recommend a program to discover the source of the problem. In order to do that, the existing given information is incomplete, and there are many loopholes in it. First, the information given is that cells of certain types of units appear to be selling fast as compared to some other types of the units. The information never gave that what types of units are selling fast. For example, like how many room, like 4-room flats or 5-room flats, as compared to what types of units. And the second information given is that the purchaser have been removing the building components of the apartments and replacing them during their renovation. As you can see from the this is the information given, and it only mentioned that what are the actions taken by the purchasers and the number of units that the action taken, and they never mentioned the unit numbers. What are the unit numbers? And what was the changes made? And also, who are the purchasers of the units that make changes to their apartments? And next information is that in project 246, and this condominium, the defects are occurred, and the number of units that the defects happen, and we never know that what are the unit numbers again, and what was the defect reported to the maintenance team, and also what are the any notification then by the maintenance team. And another piece of information given is that the problem and the defects happen to the recreational facilities as loose petals at the foot part and floating at the garden and resting of garden furniture, etc. And the information is a lack of, like, when was the defects reported, and like any notification then to the those common area defects. As to conclude, these are the informations that it is never mentioned. Those are what are the unit numbers and what are the details of the purchasers. As if we know the details of the purchaser, it will be easy to contact the owners of purchasers to make follow-up actions. And it is required to know that when did the defects reported, and it also important to know have any rectification then to the defects to their apartments as well as to the common recreational facilities. And last but not least, we have to know the details of the contractors or engineers, they refer to the defects, so that we can can make use of the track of the reports and all this. Next, I will pass to Eva.
Okay, so we're talking about the different research methods to collect data. So the first method would be hiring surveyors to actually go around the estate and asking residents to fill in surveys or questionnaires about possible defects within common areas, defects within their units, or any modification done to their units. So from the surveys that they collect, they are able to get the opinion and feedback and these modifications. And also the selection of respondents within the estate will be randomized. So the advantages of this is that there can be an assured number of results collected because the surveys are done on the spot. And when surveys are done on the spot, can actually ask for further clarification of the issues at hand. And the disadvantages would be that because it's randomized, the management will not be able to get a full view of all the defects within the premises itself, because at different areas of the premises there will be different defects and issues and concerns. For example, units that are facing the afternoon sun will tend to be warmer, and when it's warmer there will be tend a lot of cracks in the paint and hairline cracks in the wall itself due to the expansion and contraction. And also for the modification, the unit owners will tend to install blinds or change their original windows to heavily tinted ones. So yeah. The next method will be physical inspections. This will be split into two parts, from door-to-door and professional inspection. For door-to-door, as the title suggests, the surveyors will actually go from each unit's door and ask them to fill in the surveys itself. And this is a very tedious but effective method. For the professional inspection, this is actually required by statutory regulations, and the property managers actually have to carry out regular inspection of the premises itself. So for the advantages of door-to-door surveys, it's more convenient because the surveyors will actually be able to they will be able to inspect any defects on the spot because they are there already. So when they're able to identify the defects on the spot, they will first identify the severity and whether the defects was due to poor usage or it was due to poor workmanship. If the defects was due to poor workmanship, the liability falls on the management itself. So the inspector will follow up by contacting the relevant contractors to rectify the issues. For the disadvantages of door-to-door is that they will require a lot of time and manpower, and residents may also be quite skeptical about it because they might be afraid that the person coming to their doorstep might not actually be from management but might be some fraud case. Yeah. So for professional property inspection, the advantages is that when the inspectors get to witness the issues firsthand, they will be able to come up with a better analysis because they will be able to take in the surroundings. So factors like rainwater, dampness, etc. will be able to be taken into consideration on the spot. And the process will be more straightforward because they do not have to waste time actually collecting the survey result itself, but they can go straight to inspecting the defects. The disadvantages will be that it will be costly to hire inspectors to regularly inspect the premises. And the inspectors who come to inspect the premises, they must also be familiar with the area so that they will be able to identify potential defect areas. So the third method will be online survey forms. The advantages of this is that the respondents can actually do the survey at their own convenience. And this is very important because most respondents find that surveys are unpleasant because they will usually be stopped to ask to complete a survey when they're either busy or when they have something to do. So when there's more convenience, they will have more willingness to do it because they can do it on the way to work or school or etc. whenever they're free. So another advantage of this is that when survey results are generated online, you can actually use different platforms to automatically generate the results into charts or graphs, such as Google Survey Forms. They'll automatically generate the graphs for you. The disadvantage is that there's no guarantee the respondents will actually do the survey itself, and there's also no confirmed number of results because it's optional for the respondents to do it. So yeah, you'll also be uncertain of when they will actually submit it, because even if you give them a deadline, they might not comply to it. And not every resident will be technologically savvy. Which brings us to the next point, sending survey forms through their mailbox. the advantages of this is similar to the previous one, and it can be done at their own convenience. There'll be more willingness, and this additional advantage will be that this survey will be accessible even to people who are not technologically savvy, such as the elderly. The disadvantage is that they have to do an extra step by physically submitting the form at the management office, and the other disadvantages are similar to the previous one. There's no guarantee survey results will actually be received, and there's no confirmed number of results. So for the fifth method is to have regular meetings, in other words, focus group. This focus group would be optional and would be held either biannually, quarterly, or monthly. And through this, the residents will be able to openly discuss issues or concerns that they may have. So the advantages is that any concerns that they may have left out during the survey can actually be brought up during this focus group discussion, or any previously unnoticed concerns may be highlighted as well, and from there they can discuss about solutions or potential efforts that could be put in. Also, a two-way discussion between the receiver and the provider, which is the residents and the management itself, would prevent any misinterpretation of survey results, or and it will increase the efficiency as action can be taken faster. And some people may be able to better articulate their concerns through face-to-face interaction rather than through writing. The disadvantage is that it will be very time-consuming and residents might not attend at all. And it's also quite troublesome to meet frequently. So linking the case study, the ideal use of the survey methods will be actually a mix of three of it to obtain both qualitative and quantitative results. So the three mix will be online survey, physical inspection, and regular meetings. With these three combined together, there will be convenience for gathering survey results. Immediate inspection can be carried out upon the discovery of defects. You will be able to cover a large amount of residents and units, because if you go from door to door, you are ensured that a large number of responses can be received. And also by inspection of professional property managers, you'll be able to have accurate analysis. And through the focus group, you'll be able to discuss issues, concerns, mitigations, and efforts to be put in. Now I'll be passing the time to Shefali.
Developers can design a survey and questionnaire to collect and interpret data. So to design a good survey, they will need to understand the survey research process, which I'll be going through in the next few slides. So firstly, they would have to identify the research objective, and this can be derived from the understanding of the problem. Hence, this provides scope and guidance for the internal questions, which are the research questions. So these research questions can be quite complex, and they need to be broken down into simpler questionnaire items for the respondents to understand. And this will, through the scope of the problem, they will also determine the respondents of the survey. And ORIEN developers should also avoid too many objectives because this will distract them from receiving or targeting their main objective. And also, they should set an expectation and not expect too much from the survey. After identifying the objective, they will need to identify the target audience and population. So this population refers to all the members of a specific group, and this can be derived from demographic, geographic location, and occupation. So for this case, ORIEN developers are actually targeting the residents of the development. And after identifying the population, they are required to conduct an audience analysis to characterize the respondents. This will help them choose the method of survey, which can either be a pen and paper or web-based survey. They should also keep in mind to use simpler and familiar vocabulary so that the respondents will be able to understand the survey. The next will be to design the sampling plan. So basically, this is a detailed outline of which measures should be taken by what measure and by whom. So there are two considerations in this part. So it will be whether the survey is for a larger population or a smaller population. So for a larger population, a probability sampling would be used, but for a smaller or unique population, it will be a non-probability sampling. So basically, probability sampling is designed to ensure each person in the population have a fair or equal chance of participating, and this is used as a reliable estimate of the whole population. So but for this case, it would be targeting a resident, so probability sampling would be used. So next would be to design and write the questionnaire. So there are usually four types of questions to take note, so which are attributes, attitude, beliefs, and behavior. So attributes are basically demographic questions such as the age group of the respondents. Next would be attitude. Attitude would be what they feel about the question, and beliefs is what are their opinions about the question. So the wording and structure of the questionnaire is also important because the respondents are supposed to like understand the whole questionnaire. So the questions are usually in a questionnaire would be open-ended, closed-ended, and hybrid. So open-ended are questions which respondent can write any answer to, but closed-ended are questions that are respondents are supposed to choose the answer from the options. And hybrid is a mixture of both. So for so to develop a good questionnaire, orient developers should include both open-ended and closed-ended because some answers can be overlooked or it's not suitable to answer for that question. And the survey should always be objective. This is to prevent any biased opinion about the whole questionnaire, and this will distract them from receiving their main objective. So after designing the questionnaire, they would have to do a pilot test questionnaire. So basically, this pilot test questionnaire is a simulation carried on a small scale of the respondents. So throughout this pilot test questionnaire, they were able to uncover problems or weakness of the questions. So they could also find out problems whether they were facing any problems with the technology aspect. So if, for example, if the survey was conducted web-based, they need to ensure that the respondents were able to navigate themselves or the system wasn't lagging so that it would be easier to collect responses. So they should also ensure that the objectives are meaningful and the duration is not too long for the survey. If the survey is too long, respondents will not really answer honestly because their thought is to end this survey like as soon as possible because of the long duration. And also through the simulation, the orient developers should also find the satisfaction of the respondents, whether they were really happy with this survey or like whether was it too troublesome or the duration was too long. And after receiving feedbacks from the simulation carry out, they would have to make necessary improvements to make the survey better. So next would be, after making the necessary improvements, they would have to distribute the questionnaire. So to distribute the questionnaire, this is to let the respondents take the survey, and they should ensure that the respondents have enough time to take the survey. So usually 3 to 5 weeks would be a good time for respondents to take the survey. This is to ensure that if it's a little time spent, they wouldn't reach a lot of respondents to take the survey, and as such, they won't be able to understand the objective of the survey. Like, there will be insufficient data collected, and they wouldn't be able to make any conclusion from the survey. So there are also, orient developers should also keep track of the response, because if they realize that there are not enough respondents, they can be able to send the respondents a survey or to allow them to like or give them time to take the survey. This is especially for web-based questionnaire because it will be easier to send them reminders. So the last stage would be that to analyze results and write reports. So at this stage, the survey is already completed, and from this part, orient developers can actually draw conclusions from the survey and make observations. So they can use charts and graphs to actually analyze or have an in-depth understanding of what's the issue or problem of the respondents. And they should also write reports for future actions and like future reference. And after that, they should take necessary actions about from the survey results. So next, I'll pass the time to Lirin.
So I was talking about the customer profile and segmentation. First, I will talk about the customer segmentation. Customer segmentation is the practice of dividing a customer base into group of individuals that are similar in specific ways relevant to marketing, such as age, gender, interest, and spending habits. Well, actually, using segmentation allows companies to target groups effectively and allocate market resources to the best effect. There are many different approaches to segmenting the market, but the most common
The most common approach include geography segmentation, demography segmentation, psychographic and behavioral segmentation. Well, for the geography segmentations, divide the markets based on the different geographic units such as the countries, nations, states, regions, cities, and the neighborhoods. For the demography segmentation, divide the markets based on the different demographic units such as the age, gender, sex, family, education, and income. For age, actually the customer needs and wants may change with age. So some of company may use different product or use different segmentation approach for different age group. For example, like McDonald's target to teenagers, children, senior and adults with different advertisement. Compared to the scenario that for real estate, like new development always attract the young people, family or young people. For the psychographic segmentations, divide the market into groups based on the lifestyle, social class, and the personality. Last is the behavioral segmentation. It's divide the market into groups based on the usual status, usage rates, benefits of acquisition, loyalty, and altitude. For the benefits of it's recurring to finding the major benefits people are customer are looking for, such as the convenience, status, and value. For the customer loyalty, customer can be loyal to brands, company, and also the stores. Buyers can be divided into groups according to their degree of loyalty. For example, some customers are company loyal to one brand, and some others customers sometimes they will choose two or three brands, and some others show no loyalty to any brands. They either buy something different or something like whatever on sales. For the customer profile, in simple terms, a customer profile is a description of your typical customer. The process involves understanding your customer traits, behavior, and the characteristics, and then using them to inform your market efforts. But how to build a good customer profile? Normally, we will use the Google Analyze for demographic. This dashboard provides information on age and gender based on the information Google holds on visitors to your website. For social behavior, provides you with data on which social channels are directing traffic to your website. And also we can use the customer journey. Well, with segmentation is often used in conjunction with profile, but there are also some difference. For customer segmentation, it's used for mailing purpose, for example, to adjust the price strategy and also improve the products based on the needs of the customer segments. So the customer segmentation is good way to understand your customer better. However, for the customer profile, it aims to describe type of your customer. This type can be used as a tool to identify the best prospects based on the certain attributes or to improve service. Different information is combined in customer profile, such as the demographics, behavior data, and the information on lifestyle. The customer profile helps to understand customer and improve customer satisfaction. With that, I will pass my time to Nicole.
Talking about the ethical issues concerning the use of such data. So first of all, what is personal data? It refers to data from which an individual can be identified, and this includes information such as name, date of birth, your home address, and your identification number. And in Singapore, such personal data is protected under the Personal Data Protection Act, also known as PDPA. So the PDPA is actually a data protection law that comprises of various rules regarding the use of such personal data of many consumers. And it recognizes both the rights of individuals to protect their personal data, as well as the needs of companies and organizations to use this data for legitimate and reasonable purposes like research in order to find out more information about how they can serve their customers better. So what this PDPA aims to do is to promote and enforce personal data protection so as to foster an environment of trust among businesses and consumers, which will then contribute to a vibrant Singapore economy. And it's also to balance the need to protect individuals' personal data and the needs of organizations to use the data for real reasons and purposes. So why is it important? Because today, in this day and age, there are huge amounts of personal data that are being collected for almost anything and everywhere. So this data is then used to analyze, and they might even be transferred to third-party organizations for many reasons. And so with such a trend, there's always worries and concerns from consumers and individuals about how their data is then being used. So therefore, it's necessary to implement such a data protection act to regulate the use of these personal data, to address these concerns, and also to maintain individuals' trust in organizations that manage these data. So here are some examples of PDPA breaches. For this case, PropNex was fined $10,000 for a data breach because they mistakenly caused the personal data of over 1,000 people to be leaked online. And this woman actually complained to PDPC. PDPC is Personal Data Protection Commission. She actually complained that her particulars were available freely online in an unsecured PDF document. And she also said that she and her sisters received marketing calls as well as messages from telemarketers as well as even moneylenders. So therefore, PDPC then told the company to remove it. But then, so the file was removed 1 month later, but then it was too late because by then the file was actually online for many months already. So the issue, they found out to be that it was a security flaw, as although a password was required to access the web pages hosted by the system, a password was actually not required to access the documents, which could be easily searched on Google. So yeah, they were fined $10,000 for this. Next case is the insurance company Aviva. They were fined $6,000 for a data breach as well. And in this case, the insurance documents actually landed in the wrong hands of another person. To the wrong person. And these documents actually included confidential information of the intended policy holder that it was to be mailed to, such as the CPF number, IC number, date of birth, name, and all this sensitive data. So the issue actually turned out to be a systematic problem whereby the way Aviva sent out follow-up letters to its policyholders was wrong because they only had one staff member to check the documents, and there wasn't a second person to actually check to make sure that the everything is put in order. So yeah, but after that they then reviewed their policy and they actually made this letter, but they were still fined $6,000. So linking back to the case, it's always important for Orient developers to make sure that this such a thing will not happen to them. So they have to actually have a proper security process and procedure to store the data. So yeah, with that, we end our presentation.